host of environmental impacts, both from factory farm gas and infrastructure itself, but again, also from all of the pollutants that are left on the grounds, right? For trenching a system, or expanding a system, we're not addressing all of the sort of area problems of the environment. And then finally, the climate impacts. This is taking off because it's being positioned as a climate. So, to start out, digesters are not a solution to factory farming. And this is what you're going to hear from the industry colleagues, that they sort of present adding anaerobic digesters and factory farm gases to the factory farm industry as a panacea. We're going to solve the water pollution problem, not to have odors anymore. Oh, and we're creating green energy, green energy. And that's just simply not true. It doesn't work like that. The critical fact is that the waste that goes into a digester doesn't go away. It still has to be managed after the gas is removed. That's called digesting. The digestate comes out and is typically then landed or disposed of on the fields in the same way the original digested nourishment was. So that whole system remains in place. And to sort of highlight how dire this situation is. So in North Carolina, is one of the places where this movement is sort of most Smithfield pushing this really hard. Decades ago, Smithfield agreed and committed to doing better in the state of North Carolina, to improving their operations so they weren't harming communities as much. Well, they never did that. And now they want to put parks on their lagoons and build new lagoons. And so, bringing up the point that this is entrenching and making worse all of the pollution problems that were already established in the And so, that's one way that folks are trying to push back, just promoting that this is not a solution to the discriminatory practices that are happening in North Carolina and the permitting facilities and allowing them to operate when it's actually So, water quality. Why do digesters not work with water quality? So, the main problem is very high in phosphorus and nitrogen, which are beneficial to plants in appropriate amounts. So it generates so much of it that it can't be responsible for it. It's disposed of fields. And digesters actually make that pollution more hazardous to the environment, more hazardous to the environment, because the changes in chemistry of nitrogen and phosphorus makes it more water soluble. That's more likely to run off into its waters, more likely. So again, it's not a solution, it's actually exacerbating one of the critical problems. It also has, we're now finding out, a really unfortunate other problem in that the digestion process mineralizes nitrogen more so than it would otherwise, and that leads to more ammonia emissions post-digestion. So again, that handling of that digested waste causes more ammonia air emissions. Ammonia is what's known as a PM2.5 precursor. So when ammonia goes out into the atmosphere, it can be converted into PM2.5, which is a particulate matter of a certain size that's so small that it can run to raising animals does not by itself inherently have methane emission problems, and that's what we're talking about here primarily about, which is a very powerful business. Methane emissions are only a problem once waste is handled in these communities, right? It's that anaerobic environment of the cesspool that creates the methane emissions, okay? So it's an intentionally created problem to maximize profits, or better said, to reduce costs of waste management. That's like the cheapest, most rudimentary way to build the cesspool. And so what we're doing is capturing a gas that was intentionally created to maximize profits. That waste can be managed differently to avoid the methane generation in the first place. And instead, we're capturing it and then burning it, right? And burning factory farm gas is all the same kind of gas that can be fossil. So that's a huge problem. If we're treating something that could be avoided as inevitable and natural and monetizing it, right? It's good for the environment, but encouraging the soil to generate climate distributed gases by monetizing its. Another really important point is just as a matter of numbers and scale, we will never displace a meaningful amount of fossil fuel with biogas, or really all biogas sources. It's a drop in the bucket. And so what industry is doing is, this is a way for the natural gas industry, the Chevrons, the Dominion Energies of the world, to continue business as usual and greenwash their operation. So Dominion Energy, partnership with Smithfield Foods, has said to the media that if they just cut 4% factory farm gas in their gas mix, they are climate neutral. Let me say that again. 96% frack gas, 4% factory farm gas, and they're going to tell the public and they're going to pitch themselves as climate neutral. I hope you've heard of that. Great. So with all these issues, why is this being promoted so much right now? I mean, maybe I should back up a moment and say how sort of embracing this is. For one thing, these operations are not viable on their own. These are not business ventures that are self-sustainable. The reason why we're seeing biogas development in this country, biogas development, is because of these massive public sectors, huge taxpayer handouts, major pollution trading programs around the country that make these things viable. So look at the business plan for these developers, and it's not, they're not going to make money off selling the factory farm gas. They make money off what are called the environmental attributes or the credits that they can generate under these various programs. So that's why this is happening. Okay, this isn't a good business, this is us handing a lot of money to these large companies to supposedly get the climate benefits out of it. So, as I said about the natural gas industry, this is really a way to greenwash problematic operations. Right? So this allows a factory farm to say, I'm a climate steward. I'm capturing green energy from my facility. And I'm displacing fossil fuels. And the way they do the accounting, I won't get into it, but it makes it look like a digester put onto a factory farm cesspool is one of the most amazing environmental engineers in human history, because again, they treat the intentionally created emissions in the rooms as naturally occurring. So I've captured all of these greenhouse gases that are emitted, which they would have because you constructed your facility in such a way that you're outside what actually getting so is this just profiteering off pollution? Is that what we're seeing here? Is this a way for two really problematic industries who had a pretty rough time in terms of their image because folks are fed up with the impacts of how they do business, is a way for them to continue business as usual while sort of convincing folks that they've done something. I would argue that very much so is not what is happening. So again, you've got the Smithfields of the world going on, some 90% of our factory farms capturing factory farm gas for years, things like that. Few percent factory farm gas, and we're climate neutral here. And so, you know, two big areas where we can push back on this are these climate trading programs. The primary example of that is really driving resources for it to revisit how they treat this particular industry in a much more realistic way, because right now it's the most profitable alternative fuel available in the market in California, and it's pumping enormous amounts of money into people and rewarding the biggest companies who have the most unsustainable practices. They get the biggest payout in this country. And so California is a big one. It's a scoping plan right now, so there's a huge push for the agency to revisit how they're running this situation. And what we're seeing is the low carbon fuel standard in California, like the third quarter, are starting to be emulated. Other states are including the same problems in their renewable portfolio standards. The Biden administration put out what's called a methane plan, which needs to be sort of put down and implemented by agencies like Education and Agriculture. But they're really full bore on promoting that methane plan. It's really the only solution. So again, there's really not much conversation about how can we improve waste management practices at these facilities, which would benefit all sorts of things. Water quality, etc. Instead, it's like, let's just accept factory farms, lock them in, never going to change that, and let's just sort of slice this kind of rock. I'm probably over time, so with that, I'll pass it on. Thanks so much, and yeah, happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. It's a pleasure to be here today to talk a little bit about PAFOS. I am an employee concentrating in human operations. I am from Sarasota County, North Carolina. We are the second largest hog producing county in the United States. The number one hog producing county talks more to us in different counties. So, very familiar with the thank you title for spending some time talking about my organization. There are a number of problems with PAFOS and with biogas when we look at the communities where I come from. North Carolina is an agricultural state. So to that end, policies that are developed in North Carolina are very, very protective and supportive of agriculture versus other kinds of development in the state. There are key agencies in the state, like our state duty here, the Department of Commerce, who's responsible for incentivizing companies to come into the state who are not clearly determined but are more interested in the industry side of it. And so we have a list of these agencies within our communities because of the lax regulation that we see. And then it doesn't matter what we do with our state environment quality agency. They don't listen to us, and so as a result, we're constantly seeing the bombardment of all kinds of things, not just PAFOS, but cumulative impacts, which is something that we don't talk about in this community. We just don't talk about that today as well. In terms of hog operations, there are a number of different impacts. As Tyler talked about, there are the problems with waste pits. And if you have not seen one, if you can imagine an area the size of 3 football fields with nothing but hog waste in it, just as a liquid pit, that's what these buildings look like in North Carolina with these operations. So that alone is a huge health risk because you're talking about communities that already have health issues. And so these exposures are just exacerbating what these communities already experience. If you look at the locations of where these operations are, they are in majority in rural communities, predominantly communities of color and low-income communities. And there's data to show if you drew a 3-mile radius around any one of the operations, you would find that they are predominantly located where communities and low-income communities. Because of what local elected officials and state elected officials do, it's very hard to get any kind of improvements. And economic development is the justification that they give for putting these facilities in these areas, but I would argue that the presence of those facilities are creating more problems than they are doing economic development because of the increase in doctor's visits, asthma attacks, and the other kinds of things that we think about when we have the U.S. communities. And again, it's in areas of high disease rates and less medical care because it is rural. It's unlike being in an urban area where you have a medical university or some other facility. And there are actually medical deserts if you want to think about the other parts of the state. So if someone needs to drive to get to a doctor, depending on the different tools that they need to put to the doctor, which would make some of the exacerbates to the patients. As I mentioned, cumulative impacts is very important. When you see a hog farm or a swine operation in North Carolina, you are going to see poultry. The three counties in the state that have seen the largest increase in poultry are our county, Sampson County, Duke County, which is next door, which is the number one hog producer, and Robson County, which is a little bit further away, but is predominantly Native American. So to put one there brings everything else, and it's what we know about environmental justice practice is that when one facility goes in a place, it makes it more vulnerable to receive everything. So you will see those multiple locations of these various industries. As Tyler talked about, bioenergy is the buzzword these days, but they're actually talking about biogas and biomass. So there are efforts now not just to convert swine waste into gas, but to also convert poultry waste into gas because there's so many poultry in the state. Our county is the number one turkey producer in the state and number two in the nation. So we have all kinds of animals running around. And most of our areas are landfills. My county also has the largest landfill in the state. So we get trash from all over the state as well as outside of the state. That landfill is on the edge of the African American community and has been there for 40 years and just got extended for 10 years. We have a problem with Enviva, which is a wood pellet processing company that ships all of their product overseas. We have an Enviva facility there. So if you think about swine operations, you can't just think about that in a silo. We have to think about cumulative impacts that these communities are receiving. And unfortunately, when our State Department of Environmental Quality makes a decision about a permit, the only thing they look at is that one facility that applied for that permit. They do not consider all of the other exposures that a community is receiving from the performance of the program. For those of you who may not know how USDA defines a pig farm, they have two definitions. There is the animal feeding operation, which is defined as an operation with more than 1,000 animals. But a CAFO is defined as any AFO that discharges manure or wastewater into a natural or man-made ditch, stream, or manure. And in North Carolina, the average size of most of these farms is around 5,000 animals. Some can go up to as many as 14,000 animals. In a couple of situations, there are operations that have that many swine, and then an adjoining poultry operation that may be that size. So you're talking about thousands of animals within 200 or 300 yards of something that's homes with the associated spray paint to get rid of the waste. This is an example of what I saw growing. My grandparents raised animals free range. And the food was very different, the conditions were very different, and we didn't have problems with this huge accumulation of waste that we have now. Right now, in North Carolina, there are over 9 million animals in the state. Our hog farms are food, but they're under a general water permit. The state does not consider them non-discharge permits. They are considered non-discharge permits, I'm sorry. And so they don't even consider the fact that we know that these animals are flooded if there's a rain, I drove a couple of nights ago from Raleigh, and I just went home, which is about 60 miles. And about halfway down Interstate 40, I could smell the odor. We know that these operations are not supposed to spray the fields when it is wet, but we know traditionally that these farmers, because they know they can get away with it, will spray their fields before major storms so that they don't have any more problems. And inadvertently, it always happens. As I mentioned, we are number two in our production. Next year is number one. But North Carolina has four of the top 20 hog producing states. I'm sorry, hog producing counties in the United States. And we are all within 40 miles of each other. The other issue is the processing of the animals. The largest processing facility processes 32,000 hogs a day. Imagine that, and imagine what they have to do to have that many hogs processing a day. That is a small plant in Target in North Carolina, which is about 40 miles. There is a processing plant in Huntington. They don't process that many, but at one point, this facility in Target has issues and they were shipping product to the facility. This is an example of what natural paper looks like, and I'm not sure if you can see it, but sort of to the right of the lagoon, you see a sort of dark area that looks like it doesn't have trees. This is a paper that's built right on the edge of the basin, like on the wetland. And we see that all over, which is another issue with previous facilities and floods. This is another example of what that can look like. This is after a storm. And if you see down at the lower end of the red, it looks like there may be a little stream. That's a breach in that lagoon. So that the waste from that lagoon is going into the surrounding waters. And it's not just a few thousand gallons. It's usually millions of gallons that will end up in the surrounding bodies of water in the breaches. And so you see fish kills, obviously, contaminated water in local communities. Most of these communities are not on county water. They are not on county infrastructure, so they're on residential levels. And again, this is just some more information about the top 20 counties. I said North Carolina has four of the 20. And as you can see, the number of hogs in each one of those counties and the minority population. So it's very clear that minority population and where they're located. In my home county, there are 33 hogs per every person in the county. In Duplin County, there are more than 40 hogs per every person in the county. So that is the kind of condition that local communities have to exist under because of the way that the legislature and the federal government for that matter. I wanted to share this with you. This always blows everybody's mind. The red dots are hog farms. The purple dots are poultry farms, but the problem with poultry in our state is that poultry is not regulated by anybody. So we don't know where those poultry farms are. All a poultry farm has to do is meet the local building requirements. They don't have to register with the state, they don't have to get a permit. And so as a result, there's been a huge proliferation of poultry in the county I live in Duplin County, which is next door, and in Robeson County, which is just on the other side of Cumberland, which is sort of over this way. So we don't know what to do. We are literally under attack every day from the county, but it's a little bit more than that. But that is what it looks like. But if you go down roads and you assume these counties, because most of the times these operations are sitting back off the road behind a line of trees or shrub or something that doesn't allow you to see people. And if you don't know what the signs are like, you're going to recognize that it's a very small sign sitting in front of the road. But that is just a demonstration of how far you see the things that you see. As I said earlier, the general permit that these operations are permitted under is a non-discharge permit. And so obviously that creates a lot of problems for us. ability to treat wastewater. Once that water gets into stream, we are finding, because we're doing some pre-water testing for the nonprofit, but we haven't seen some kind of finding high levels of nitrate, high levels of arsenic, which would be associated with poultry, high levels of lead, and I'm sure the lead is coming from old pipes and homes, or in some places where we have a great pump for top of the field, and that goes used to be, if you're being exposed to the grain iron that's coming out of the lead and the humans. So we are concerned, and high levels of total pump. Now, an interesting story about the total pump form is when we found that, we called our state department, and we were told that it would be up to the homeowner, mind you, who is low income, probably retired, already buying bottled water the same trust that but it was up to the homeowner to conduct the test to determine whether this coliform was human or animal. And if it was animal, then they should call the State Department of Agriculture to see if it was animal. Now, you tell me how logical that sounds in a state that supports the animal. So we, as an organization, are trying to start thinking strategically about what we can do if we continue to find these kinds of situations to help these folks who are buying our work. The area residents obviously want safe water, want to live in an environment that allows them a certain quality of life, but they can't do that now. 4 to 5 years ago, there were some nuisance lawsuits filed from the state. And Murphy Brown, who was the precursor to Smith, alleging that these folks who lived around these operations were being denied a certain quality of life because of the odor, the smells, the spray field, and all the things associated with it. And the trucks going in and out of these operations. As a result of those lawsuits, State General Assembly passed a law basically that would prevent anyone from filing lawsuits in the country. So there was no really eagerness for members of the community to be able to do anything. On top of that, in 2021, the state legislature passed a farm bill that now allows digesters to be installed on these farms, and it is a general digester permit. So it's a one-size-fits-all. Very little monitoring, but there's not a lot of monitoring now, but this will give them less. As Tyler referred to, they would be able to even dig it up in the lake, because one of the requirements is that the effluent from the digester process has to go into a marine lagoon. And some of these operations now don't have the lagoon that would be appropriate for the effluent from the digester process to go into. So they would be able to dig it up with them on their property, potentially closer to the next man than the buildings that they have on the property. So that potentially is another problem that is going to create a lot of issues for folks who live there. And as I mentioned, we've been doing some work testing and use some of the things that have been and we're continuing that. And this was intended as a service because so many of the residents in our county can't afford to pay $75+ to the health department to run a water test, even though they may suspect that they may not be healthy for them to run it. As I mentioned, there has been a legislation to treat the protection of the industry. There have not been any more operations built, which is the 2018, but because of the protections that are already in place, it's very important that local citizens continue to have the presence of the operations, or about trying to force the State Department of Environmental Quality to do anything that would be really stringent. Because of the way the State Department of Environmental Quality works, at this point, in most situations, those operations are inspected maybe once a week, but no more. Some of them go longer than a year without having inspection. The breaches or violations of the permits that they're under are voluntary for them to report if something happens in the county. So again, we have no idea in those situations what is actually going on in the county. We just know that from time to time there will be a fish kill and connect that to the pond and say, oh, no, no, there wasn't a pond, that got too big. But our one of our partners is Hickory River, so they've done a really good job of identifying these fish kills and when they happen. So that's been helpful to some extent, but still we don't have state and local elected officials and state agencies who are helpful to you as a community. There's not a lot of different. And as I said, there's a lack of monitoring. The state does not require any monitoring, either of the water, they are aware that there is oversaturation or overspraying of the majority of fields with the effluent from the lagoons. But because it was so seldom reviewed or evaluated or checked, it's hard to know where those violations are happening. Another funny story, a few years ago, there was an individual who saw a field that was being sprayed for a storm, which is not supposed to happen, and called the state anonymous reporting line to report that this was being done illegally. That person got a call back from the farmer later on that afternoon saying, why did you call? So that is the kind of thing that oftentimes in communities are reluctant to say anything because everybody's very protective of this industry versus being protected. And I want to talk a little bit about biogas. As I said, Kelly did a really good job talking about biogas, but I want to sort of give you more of a personal feeling of what it's like. And I'm just going to skip this slide. This is a process, and you saw that earlier, but basically you've got the hog house, you wash the hog house, it brings up into the lagoon, but the lagoon is covered with that tarp-like film, and once the process is finished, the digestate from that process ends up in the lagoon, and then that digestate is sprayed on the joint fields. And some of the fields that are sprayed with that digestate is where farmers say they grow their organic vegetables. So I've become very careful about what I buy that's labeled organic because I'm not growing that, because they consider this natural fertilizer that they can actually grow things in the natural place. This is just a infogram that Southern Environmental Law Center put together for us for general information. It's on their website. If you want to learn more about biogas, I would suggest you go there to actually see the process. Tyler has done a good job talking about what some of the toxins are that result from this process that's supposed to be good for us. He mentioned briefly a line, RNG, which is the collaboration between Smithfield and Community Energy. That facility happens to be on the border of my county and the adjoining county. It is it's going to be a pretty large facility, but you wouldn't know that facility was there if you didn't know exactly where it was. The sign out in front of it is about a 2x3 sign on the side of the major highway. When we started talking with community members to find out how they felt about it and to try to get them engaged about what was going on during the time that the state DEP was in the process of permitting it, the community was surprised because they thought it was just an addition to something else that's there. Remember I talked about community impacts. In that area where that online biogas facility is going to be is a feed silo for Smithfield, is a cornfield across the street. Behind that cornfield is a CAFO. That cornfield is a spray field for the CAFO that's behind the trees. There is a county trash dump that's approved. The Smithfield headquarters are sitting there. So they have trucks coming and going that they're servicing, that they're washing, that they're cleaning. It's right off of Interstate 40, which is a major highway, so they've got 18-wheelers coming and going all the time. down the road less than a mile is a warehouse that just recently got bought by another company who intends to truck waste from hog farms to the warehouse and convert it into some kind of energy. We aren't quite sure what yet. And so this little community that's just a few hundred people are now concerned that they're going to have two facilities within a mile of each other producing this renewable natural gas, and they have no idea what's going to happen to the water. They know their air is going to become worse. The soil is probably going to be worse, and they know that everything else that we're doing is going to be worse. And we're talking about a community that is predominantly minority and probably older people. We haven't done a lot of the demographics yet. They've reached out to us because they have some concerns now with these two facilities. Line, this is the map. We do know that Line and Smithfield plan to hook up 19 farms to this facility that they have proposed. Those farms, some of them are as far away as 15 miles. So we anticipate that they're going to be putting in a maze of about 30 miles of pipeline to transmit this renewable natural gas to this facility to be processed. And I didn't talk about the flaring that's going to be happening once that facility is finished for those folks that are already getting all of those other communities. That hasn't been accounted for either. So this is the path. And the community is concerned because while it sounds good and looks like it may make sense on paper, you're talking about disrupting communities, the pipeline that's going to have to go in to accommodate the transport of this methane from these farms to that facility. Again, it's going to be ultimately a maze of about 30 miles. The two farms that are being hooked up now are about 15 miles away. And so we've heard from community members concerned about what that means for their community. If there's an explosion, we understand that the potential administration has asked for some type of waiver so that if there is any kind of explosion or disruption along that line, there's nothing. So there are a lot of concerns about what the industry is proposing to this system. And again, obviously, they're disproportionate harms because the communities are predominantly African-American. And if you look at the data, Native American, African-American, and Latinx Americans are 2.18, 1.54, 1.39 times more likely than whites to live within 3 miles of any of these operations. So there's less concern from the majority of the community, although most of these families are more minority than they are majority. So I didn't talk about poultry. I did talk about poultry a little bit, but this is my last talk this slide. What to do? But we have poultry here as well. We've got 4,800 poultry operations that we know of. And like I said, we have anything like that. I'm not there is the largest poultry processing in Robinson, and they process 540,000 chickens. So these are the problems that we're facing in the state. It's agriculture, it's poultry, it's swine, it's all of the bad things that go on with it. And so we hope that folks will start paying attention to what you're eating, where it's coming from.
Thank you so much, Sherry. Next, we're going to go into
All right, awesome. Thank you so much for having me. So we are asking for trust. We are the only Water Keeper Alliance nonprofit member representing workers. We have 17 water keepers in the Chesapeake region, but we are the only one that's representing of Maryland, parts of Virginia, as well as Lower Sussex County. So we've talked a lot about biogas and how these facilities are placed. I just wanted to talk about a little bit of the work that you've done over the last couple of years and kind of what brought me to this work that I do now. So this is actually the Lower Shore Safe Well Initiative was funded by S&P for Trust, Center for Progressive Reform, and one of the three projects I'm doing this. We ran it for about a year. We wanted to test private wells in the lower Somerset. You can see here how many actually participated. And we wanted to measure the levels of nitrate and nitrite in private wells because currently Maryland is running the 5 U.S. agencies well above protections. And the 2020 report that came out that kind of prompted this was found that nearly 1 in 25 private drinking wells in the country was kind of like unsafe nitrate. And this is primarily due to in feeding operations, which produce nearly 2,800 tons of nitrate-rich waste. That's equivalent to 70 fully loaded 18-wheelers, okay? More than this. And of course, this is because of the rapid use of poultry manure. We don't have hog farms in the shore, but as well as discharges from family septic systems. And of course, nitrate consumption so what brought me to this work? I co-founded Concerned Citizens Against Industrial PFOS, also called CCAIC, in 2015. We successfully fought off a proposed 13-house PFO complex in the program. We successfully reduced house numbers in several other projects in the three local counties. We changed a lot of ag and residential zoning due to a public outcry for better regulations, environmental justice issues. We hosted several really successful town halls, community events, and NDE meetings with legislators, and really started a massive movement on shore regarding environmental justice and health disparities. We introduced the Community Healthy Air Act, also known as CHA, into legislature in 2017, 18, and 19, and collectively worked with other groups to introduce screening tools into our permitting system, from EJ screening. We also have something called the MDE Open Portal, which allows residents and community members to see what's going on in our Maryland Department of the And we have many other legislations that we've worked on. So going back to that Community Healthy Air Act, it would have required NDE to conduct a one-time study that identifies air pollutants by PFOS and assess any public health risks due to the Delmarva Chicken Association repeatedly demanding during our huge fights a few years ago that there wasn't any data. And this literally, you know, we fought back and forth for years, and they're like, oh, well, there isn't any data for these for sure, so we don't know what's going on, and we don't believe that there's any public health risk. So what did we do? We literally collectively, as a multi-group coalition, we said, okay, well, let's introduce a bill that would literally get this data in the Maryland General Assembly. And we worked on it for 3 years, and it was never done. Which is extremely unfortunate. And then to undermine our 3+ year effort on the Community Healthy Track, the Maryland Department of Environment, the Delmarva Chicken Association, and Chief Gamble Foundation decided to fund their own stuff and not involve any citizen input or any of the groups that work on the job, and allowed the Delmarva Chicken Association, which used to be called Delmarva Poultry Industry, to choose their own solutions for the project, and didn't allow the focus on the site to be used in public policy. So we literally collected
citizen-led legislation in the city. So a couple years later, we decided to go to court and ask the Coastal Trust in 2020 challenge the state's paper, arguing that it has failed to account for the industry's largest pollution source, which is ammonia emissions. When ammonia emissions are in the ground, it deposits into a form of nitrogen, which is literally contributing to the degrading environmental impacts of the Chesapeake Bay as well as the emissions here on the coast. The court agreed in March of 2021 that, yes, the Maryland Department of Environment must regulate ammonia from poultry farms, which is probably, this is one of the biggest, lawsuits we've ever accomplished as water keepers and other, groups that have helped us with this lawsuit. However, after an entire year of trying to negotiate a settlement and appealed the lower court's decision requiring the department to address the millions of pounds of ammonia pollution each year from the poultry. And we are going back to court and probably will be held sometime this fall, maybe in October. And it's going to Maryland's highest court. So I want to just kind of highlight some of the projected confirmed biogas projects in Maryland. I did include the Delaware ones just kind of for overall view. So the red are going to be confirmed. We have quite a few happening in Delaware that Maria nicely put out for us. We have the yellow, which are the proposed, and the blue, which are currently operational. And the map to the right is the human vulnerability of climate change. You can see the dark red is mostly Sussex County, Delaware, but we also have portions in Worcester, Somerset, and Wicomico counties. Those are the populations with the highest vulnerability, that literally are going to be impacted by climate change, already are exposed to tons and tons of emissions and toxics through their drinking water and your air pollutions, and then of course the next color down, which is like that orangish color, is the next step down. So literally only a small portion of the East majority of sulfur is not considered in a high level. And you can literally see where they're placing these biogas projects. All of them are a little bit different from each other. Some of them are on farms, some of them are trying to get tapped into the pipeline. So I wanted to kind of end this moment a really great one. So EarthCare LLC was a publicly funded biogas facility that wanted to be placed in our county. Maria and I fought really hard this past, and Layla too, fought really hard this past fall and to try to get this public shut down. And you can see the small pin, yellow pin here, is where they wanted to place it. Just north of that, up here, is the Wicomico. It is a huge landfill, and we have several different other industrial types of things going on around this area. And then the area on the right, that all of these hundreds of homes are all low-income people of color and people whose English is not their first language communities that have been identified and are already burdened by the amount of air pollution and other toxic chemicals impacting their quality of life. So EarthCare LLC, just to kind of give everybody an understanding, this is publicly funded money through the Waste Technology Fund. They were promised $2.24 million from Maryland Department of Agriculture in funding. That's over 50% of their funds. And literally less than a 1 mile neighborhood from the 80th to 90th percentile of air toxic and cancers and hazardous waste toxins, as well as various sections of people of color logistically isolated percentile from the 80th to 100%. Okay. They also wanted to process dewatered municipal sewage, dewatered DAP sludge, and that's from the poultry processing, to offset the cost of purchasing broiler litter through hauler chickens. They were literally going to start burning and processing toxic sewage and DAP sludge so that they could offset offset the cost of buying the boiler, even though 50% of their cost to build the system is funded by Maryland. And this is kind of give an overall, this would have required air, national pollution discharge permits, sewage sludge permits, all through the Maryland. And this literally would have approximately burned 12 million BTU of stranded excess waste and over 3.5 tons of boiler water for their power. I mean, that is an insane amount of toxic stuff going into Lifetime Fuels. And this actually is only a few miles from where we bought that 13-foot capacity. Just kind of did a little bit of restriction. And of course, this fall, we actively defunded this project. As soon as we started posting some meetings and online webinars identifying the fact that this was one of the most problematic sites and one of the problematic problems that we're having in Maryland with these facilities, the Maryland Department of Agriculture approved their funding, and so far the tariff has not come back. But now we are currently finding out that Bioenergy Devco, a facility that Maria identified in Delaware, and also is operating a facility in Jessup, Maryland, is now actively seeking one. So we have another battle, unfortunately, to find. And I hope this has been helpful. This is my contact information if you have any questions or concerns. Maria, Layla, and I work actively together on the shore to help offset the environmental burdens and highlight all of the degradations that we have.
Gabby, thank you. So sorry to cut you off because we have to get folks to lunch. We're going to let our one last speaker here, Layla Barrera Krause, take over.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Layla. Yes, thank you. So, thank you for giving up for our panelists. So we have a list of questions here. But I do want to open it up to a Q&A for anyone that's here and may have a question. Seeing that there may be no questions, folks, anything else? All right, then we will conclude the session. Thank you for attending Agriculture, KFES, and Biocast. So it's a real community. I hope you all got a lot out of this session.